Father God, it is our privilege that we can be here this morning. And we ask, Father God, that by your Holy Spirit, as we open up the word this morning, that you would open it up to our hearts and our ears. We ask that you will provide for us some truth, some insight that we can take away and reflect on this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. I remember after my dad's accident, there was a slow process of recovery. First, it was to see if he would get through the next night. Then it was to see if he would survive an infection. Then it was to see if he could come off the respirator. And then it was to see if he could sit out of bed. Even the doctors were surprised that he survived ICU and was discharged into rehab. And I thought that would be the hardest hurdle. But I remember when Dad was getting ready for discharge from his rehab unit, where he had been for many, many months, Dad said to me that the idea of going home was hard. And it was hard, he said, because he had been so institutionalised. Having people always around, a buzzer away, was comforting. Having routines of meals and pills and exercises that became familiar. It became safe. Going home can be scary, and he was aware of this. Becoming institutionalized is a process where beliefs, values, and certain types of behavior become so embedded in a social group or in an individual that they lose any sense of who they are. For individuals, it describes a pattern of submissiveness and a loss of identity as they take on the identity of the institution. I read a testimony of someone who had been in a maximum security prison for 3 years. And after their release, they hated the outside. They just wanted to go back to prison. Everything on the inside, even the isolation, being confined, the routine, all of those things felt familiar and safe. Even though this person could acknowledge that people on the outside in her outside life were trying to be supportive, to her, their presence just felt intrusive. Going outside her home caused a lot of anxiety, and she said she would need to go home and have a nap because it was all just very exhausting. My dad understood this dynamic of institutionalization after being in a long time in a rehabilitation hospital. And it was made harder, I think, as an older person. And he worked very hard at reclaiming those things that were part of who he was. And he's now lived at home independently, coming on 9 years. And he's in his 90s. I think that's quite an achievement. Today, we're looking at a covenant that God made with Moses, when the Israelites were well and truly compressed into the institution of slavery. And that made a huge impact on their ability to engage in a covenant agreement. We've been looking at those patterns in covenant that occur in Scripture. And every time that God made a covenant with people, we see that there is a progressive revelation of who God is and his loving ways in which God desires to interact and fellowship with humanity. And here we can see a layering of truth in Scripture. There's that magnificent, overarching plan of God's salvation, God's commitment to restoring the world and humanity back to its beautiful, creative plan for life, not death. And we can also see how each of these covenants becomes a roadmap of our own journey with God as well, and how we progressively grow in our deeper relationship with God. Last week, we looked at the covenant God made with Abraham and how God is showing Abraham that he wants to be in a relationship that is different from the gods around him. a God of love and relationship, like father and son, like family. So let's read about the next covenant in the Old Testament, and this is the one that God made with the Israelites through Moses. So we'll read that from Exodus 19 from verse 1. In the third month after the Israelites left Egypt, on the very day they came to the desert of Sinai. And after they had set out from Rephidim, they entered the desert of Sinai, and the Israelites camped there in the desert in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain and said, "This is what you are to say to the house of Jacob, and what you are to tell the people of Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did to Egypt, how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words you are to speak to the Israelites." So Moses went back and summoned the elders of the people and set before them all the words of the Lord that he had commanded him to speak. The people responded together, We will do everything the Lord has said." So Moses brought their answer back to the Lord. Moses and his brother Aaron were chosen by God to lead the greatest rescue of a people group in history. Egypt's entire Hebrew slave force, 600,000 Jews, left their chains in Egypt, and God was taking them to a new land to occupy as a free nation, to a land God described as a land flowing with milk and honey. They have been in Egypt for 300 years, a history of slavery and forced labor. These people know nothing of freedom, except family stories handed down about Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They are completely institutionalized into an identity as slaves. Their experience is being told what to do, when to do it, and how to do it. Their experience meant nothing really belongs to them, and what they did have could be seconded by the Egyptians at any time, including their wives and children. No rights, no respect, no dignity. And three months after their miraculous rescue, they come to the foothills of Mount Sinai. This is a barren wilderness. And what they see is not matching the picture that Moses had painted of a land flowing with milk and honey. Could God actually be trusted? Was Moses really who he said he was? Or was he just another slave driver working to his own agenda? And the people of Israel are having a difficult time to understand their relationship with God. I think when we look at the covenant with Moses and the people of Israel, it is important to remember that these were a subjugated people, institutionalized by oppression. You don't go from a family history and a personal history that overwhelming, even after walking through the Red Sea on dry ground, and walk out the other side as people who get it. They don't trust those in authority because authority has betrayed them. They don't trust gods because the Egyptian gods didn't help them. They don't know how long this is going to last because the only thing that lasted before was slave work demanded by slave drivers making more bricks for 300 years. But here at Mount Sinai, God is using language that is not slave driver language. God has spoken about an inheritance, about a land of abundance, about a place of safety and security, freedom and a new identity. He said he carried them to safety on eagle's wings. He speaks of his desire to make them his treasured possession. Out of all the nations, he said, I will make you my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. This is not another form of oppression where they are owned as chattels. God wants to reclaim these people as his family. Everything about the covenant with Abraham remains true. This is a gentle invitation. And that is so, so weird if you have only known authority to be oppressive and dominating and cruel. God is using the language of love. This is what a man says to a woman when he wants her to know that she is very, very special to him. A suitor using the language of courtship. This is what a man says when he's in love and is seeking to have his affections returned. This is wanting to take a relationship of love to a new level of intimacy. Mutual, exclusive, honouring, beautiful. God is taking on the role of a suitor, courting and showing the people of Israel that he loves them. He has chosen them out of all the nations of the world. He has set his eyes on them to make them special unto himself. A kingdom of priests, holy and clean and close. They had their family stories handed down to them of the covenants of Adam, Noah, and Abraham, but in their experience, there is probably only one covenant that they could relate to, the covenant of marriage that they had witnessed about them. So God uses this covenant to model the relationship with them that he wanted to pursue as the best way to describe the relationship he wanted with Israel. It is the idea of a courtship and a wedding ceremony, a people loved like a groom loves his bride, not a people of oppression. He wants these people to be like a bride to him, loving and faithful and exclusive. This passage literally describes an invitation to be exclusively devoted. God doesn't tell them that they have to do this, otherwise it is just another form of slavery and oppression. He asks if they want to be part of this. They are invited. Moses sits down and explains what's going on. He presents what God is proposing here, and he gives them time to consider the terms of this covenant. This was an invitation to make a covenant of fidelity to one God, with a God who is loving and gracious and protective and devoted. This was an invitation that was way outside the framework that this tribe of slaves with a history of 300 years of oppression could comprehend. And yet, still God persists. He doesn't leave them to it. He is patient with them. He takes them on a progressive journey of learning, learning to love, learning that God offers spiritual security more than where they have been. Learning that God can be trusted and he will provide what they need. Learning that God is good and gracious, but he is also holy and sacred. Learning that God is majestic and powerful and needs to be honored with respect. So let's continue to read from that passage from verse 10. And the Lord said to Moses, go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow and have them wash their clothes. And be ready on the third day, because on that day the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. Put limits for the people around the mountain and tell them, be careful that you do not go up to the mountain or touch the foot of it. Whoever touches the mountain shall surely be put to death. Verse 14, and after Moses had gone down the mountain to the people, he consecrated them and they washed their clothes. And then he said to the people, prepare yourselves for the third day abstain from sexual relations. And on the morning of the third day, there was thunder and lightning and a thick cloud over the mountain and a very loud trumpet blast. Everyone in the camp trembled. Then Moses led the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because the Lord had descended on it in fire. Smoke billowed up from it and like the smoke from a furnace, and the whole mountain trembled violently, and the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder. And then Moses spoke, and the voice of God answered him. The Lord descended to the top of Mount Sinai and called Moses to the top of the mountain. So Moses went up, and the Lord said to him, go down and warn the people so that they do not force their way through to see the Lord, and many of them perish. Even the priests who approach the Lord must consecrate themselves. So here is the idea that God is inviting the people into a covenant, something that they would understand reflects a marriage covenant or a marriage relationship, drawing closer than they had ever been before. But as we read this passage, it doesn't sound like God is drawing them in. It sounds like he's telling them to stay away. So as I sat with this idea, this is what I noticed. Perhaps God is saying, I will meet with you, but I will set limits. Be respectful. Don't force your way through. Wait until you consecrate yourselves. The ceremonial cleansing before a marriage ceremony was part of their tradition. It's part of ours. I watched my daughter prepare for her wedding day, and she took such particular attention and care to prepare herself for her wedding. The bride prepares, she bathes, hair, nails, makeup, gown. This is special. We don't come in from making bricks and kilns and barge straight into a marriage bed reeking of mud. And even in a culture of slavery, if that's what happened in the past, now we get to do it differently. We wash, we put on clean clothes, specially fitted, specially prepared. The bride and groom make an effort to present themselves to each other clean and beautiful. The care and preparation signifies how special this moment is. So Moses stands to represent the people who were to be set apart for this encounter as special and sacred. That takes intention and care and respect. This is a sober and holy moment. It is a moment of covenant. One of the beautiful traditions in a Jewish wedding is that the bride and groom stand under a canopy called a huppah. This wedding canopy consists of a cloth supported by four poles. And it is a symbol of God's presence at the wedding ceremony and in the home that is being established under the canopy. It is said that the divine name hovers above the huppah, sanctifying the space below. In this story, I see a canopy of smoke covering the mountain. I see divine name hovering above and sanctifying the space below. I see an incredible encounter with a supernatural God and a people he desires to be his treasured possession, set apart as holy. I see a powerful, awe-inspiring, sacred moment, establishing a new covenant together. In any covenant, there are terms of the arrangement. Setting limits creates a sense of sacred boundary. Moses understood God's instructions, put limits around the mountain and set it apart as holy. And in any respectful relationship, boundaries are critical. We won't barge in and take your stuff. We won't make you do whatever we want you to do. We won't make things happen on our whim We will take care to respect and honor what is your responsibility and what is mine. God is communicating how serious he is about these boundaries. His desire is that they would be their exclusive one God, and to do that in a way that respects and honors each party. God is still the all-powerful. He is the creator God. He is the all-sufficient one. These limits create an awareness that this moment, in this place, it was set apart as a holy, holy moment. Familiarity and contempt is not honoring. And from here on, everything changes. Now we are in covenant. So let's read those words of covenant from Exodus chapter 20, verse 1. And God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in any form of anything. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do your work, but on the seventh day is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work. Honor your father and mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. And when the people saw the thunder and the lightning and they heard the trumpet and saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance. Exodus 24, verse 3. When Moses went and told the people all the Lord's words and laws, they responded with one voice, "Everything the Lord has said, we will do." And Moses wrote down everything the Lord had said. He got up early the next morning, built an altar at the foot of the mountain and set up 12 stone pillars representing the 12 tribes of Israel. And then he sent a young Israelite men and they offered burnt offerings and sacrificed young bulls as fellowship offerings to the Lord. Moses took half of the blood and he put it in bowls and the other half he sprinkled on the altar. And then he took the book of the covenant and he read it to the people. And they responded, we will do everything the Lord has said, we will obey. Moses then took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, this is the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words. Moses, Aaron, Nadab, Abihu, and 70 elders of Israel went up. And they saw the God of Israel. Under his feet was something like a pavement made of sapphire, clear as the sky itself. But God did not raise his hand against these leaders of Israelites. They saw God and they ate and drank. Moses and the Hebrews are entering covenant with God. And we notice another progression that is different from the covenants God made with Adam, Noah, and Abraham. Now God puts it in writing. He makes it clear. He writes out the people's obligations and what his promises are. This is what their relationship will look like. When our daughter went to India, she had the privilege of attending a traditional marriage ceremony. And she described how the parents and the elders came representing the groom and the bride and they all sat down together and they discussed and they laid out what their life would look like as a married couple. When we were in Granada in Spain, we visited a museum that had an ancient Hebrew display and I saw there a beautiful scroll called a ketubah. That is the traditional document of a Jewish marriage covenant. It was a long, ornate scroll, and this document put in writing the expectations of the marriage, drawing on the wisdom of those significant people in their lives as they write up the terms of their relationship. What is okay and what is not okay? This is not just a certificate. This was a formal, intentional, detailed document. In many ways, I wish a ketubah was a normal part of Australian relationship traditions. I sit in rooms with people who have never had these conversations. They assume, and the assumptions they make are often inaccurate. God is stepping into a covenant and he is not making any assumptions. He is laying out clearly what appropriate behaviour looks like in this relationship. I've heard these commandments described like this. You shall have no other gods before me. In other words, you won't sleep around. We are going to be exclusive. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything. You won't carry pictures of lovers in your wallet. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God and take my name in vain. You won't sign any checks or put my name on anything that I wouldn't endorse or that misrepresents me. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. As a slave, you had to work 24/7. That changes now. You get a full day off every week. We're going to set aside some quality time together, just you and me. The next group of instructions are about how they are to respect each other and the people around them. And then Moses spends the next three chapters, chapters 20 to 23, describing what that looks like in more detail. This is what life looks like now that they are no longer slaves. They will not steal, lie, covet, or be disrespectful. They were not just 10 commandments, but Moses started with three chapters of explanation. And then later on, this was fleshed out in even greater detail throughout the five books of the law. And it was to answer the question, how does a nation of holy priests live in a way that is fair and respectful and honouring? The covenant clarifies what life looks like now that they are not slaves, now that they are a treasured possession of a Most High God. It is so detailed because they are starting from nothing. They had no idea. God is rebuilding their identity into one that is robust and significant. And what is surprising is that life can be fair. No Egyptians will come in on a whim and rape their wives and their daughters. No slave drivers will come and take their stuff or kill their stock. No Egyptians will move their boundaries because they felt like it, or give false testimony to suit their own agendas, or flog them or kill them when they mess up. Suddenly, they are introduced to life through a different lens, a lens that is just as well as having a covering of grace. And then we see this beautiful picture of the elders as they sit down together and they put their signature on this covenant document. The terms of the covenant are read out and they make public declarations of their commitment to this agreement. To seal this covenant, there are sacrifices. The covenant is settled with sacrificial blood to seal the agreement. 12 memorial stones are set up, a physical token representing the covenant with 12 tribes of Israel. And then in verses 10 and 11, we see God comes and reveals himself in a physical form to the elders. They saw God, it says, and they ate and drank with him. They share a meal together. They fellowshiped. They communed. This was a feast. They ate with God. Sharing a meal is a traditional way to ratify a covenant between parties. We see that same symbolism in a marriage wedding reception. There is meaning in a wedding reception. It's not just an excuse for a party. So let's continue reading from Exodus 25, verse 17. Make an atonement cover over the ark of pure gold, 2.5 cubits long and 1.5 cubits wide, and make 2 cherubim out of hammered gold at the ends of the cover, and make 1 cherub on one end and the 2nd cherub on the other, and make the cherubim of 1 piece with the cover at the 2 ends. And the cherubim shall stretch forth their wings upwards, covering the mercy seat with their wings, facing one another but looking down on it. Place 1 cherub at one end and 1 at the other. You are to make the 2 ends of the mercy seat and of 1 piece with it. And there above the cover, between the 2 cherubim that are over the ark of the covenant law, I will meet with you and give you all my commands for the Israelites. God gives Moses the plans to build a magnificent tabernacle of worship. And they would take this with them as a place of worship in the years they lived as nomads in the wilderness. The tabernacle contained beautiful articles of worship. God didn't wait for them to arrive in their new land, but he provided this tabernacle now as an important symbol of the progressive revelation of their relationship with God. I think there's one thing that can be missed with all of the structural details as we read the description of the tabernacle. This was a beautiful and outstanding structure. There were royal fabrics, rich inlays, furnishes created by master artisans anointed by God to execute their craft. This was not a make-do worship center for slaves, but a place of worship worthy of their magnificent God, worthy of his people who were his treasured possession. Just months ago, they were making mud bricks under the lash of the Egyptians. Now they had this magnificent tabernacle, which was the center point wherever they made camp as they traveled. It was beautiful to reflect the radiance of God's presence. And part of that progressive revelation was that they no longer needed to climb a mountain to get close to God. Noah met God on Mount Ararat. Abraham worshipped God on Mount Moriah. Moses met with God on Mount Sinai. Now God dwells within the tabernacle, within the camp. God's presence is close, near, just there, central to the way their 12 tribal camps were laid out around the tabernacle. And in the tabernacle, there were many articles of worship. Each had its own meaning and symbolism. The sacrificial altar, the brazen laver, the altar of incense, the table of shewbread, the menorah candlestick. And in the innermost holy place was the most sacred of all the articles of worship, the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant was the symbol that represented the love covenant between God and the people. Inside the precious golden ark were the stone tablets on which was written the summary of the agreement between God and the Israelites. There was also the Book of the Law, the scrolls where Moses had written out in detail the agreement between God and the Israelites. There was also the staff of Aaron that was made of almond wood. God had supernaturally caused this staff to bud, blossom, and fruit as a sign to the people that the Levites were set apart to serve as priests. What was seen as dead and barren was given life and fruitfulness. And there was also a bowl of manna, a sample of God's miraculous provision during their wilderness journey that supernaturally did not spoil. The Ark of the Covenant held the Articles of Agreement. There was their part, the Ten Commandments, the terms of behavior written in the law. There was God's part, the gift of the priesthood serving before the people, the staff of Aaron, the promise of life and fruitfulness. God's part, provision and care and sustenance, the bowl of manna. And overlaying the ark was a covering made of pure gold. And it was called the mercy seat or the atonement cover. It is space between the two cherubim, a place where the blood of the sacrifice on the Day of Atonement was sprinkled. It represented having our sins covered and forgiveness imparted. It physically demonstrated transforming the place where God sits from a judgment seat to a mercy seat. God was taking the people on a progressive revelation. This covenant was not a covenant of judgment and condemnation like a slave driver or the fickle kings and pharaohs of Egypt. It was covered with mercy, atonement, protection, a covering of love. The mercy seat was also a place of connection and communion. It was from the mercy seat where God would meet and impart wisdom to Moses for the people. Redemption was imparted, atonement was completed, forgiveness was given, wisdom and counsel was provided, connection and communion is revealed. It's an incredible promise and symbol. And then at the end of 40 years of wandering in the wilderness, in the desert of Moab, just before Moses died in the wilderness, there is a beautiful record of God renewing the covenant with the Israelites. And I want to read that because I think it is a lovely summary in the Word of God about this covenant. Deuteronomy 29 from verse 2. Moses summoned all the Israelites and said to them, "Your eyes have seen all that the Lord did in Egypt to Pharaoh and to all his officials and to his land. With your own eyes you saw those great trials, those miraculous signs and great wonders. During the 40 years that I led you through the desert, your clothes did not wear out, nor did your sandals on your feet. You ate no bread and drank no wine or other fermented drink. I did this so that you might know that I am the Lord your God. Carefully follow the terms of this covenant so that you may prosper in everything that you do. All of you standing today in the presence of the Lord your God, your leaders and chief men, your elders and officials, all the other men in Israel, together with your children and your wives, you are standing here in order to enter into a covenant with the Lord your God, a covenant the Lord is making with you this day and sealing with an oath to confirm to you this day as his people that he may be your God as he promised. And he has sworn to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I am making this covenant with an oath, not only to you who are standing here with us today in the presence of the Lord, but also with those who are not here today." This was a solemn declaration. These were God's people renewing their binding covenant of love and faithfulness. They understood that God goes with them as they are ready to occupy the land that was promised to them as their inheritance, that God faithfully loves them as his treasured possession. And in covenant, they promise to love and be faithful to him. So let's pause and think about some questions around this profound covenant that God made with Moses and the people of Israel. Can I identify ways I have been institutionalized so that slavery becomes normal? Do I think of my commitment to God as something as serious and as sacred as a marriage covenant. Does anything change if I think about the Ten Commandments more like a marriage ketubah rather than a list of unattainable rules? How do I respond to this invitation that God wants me to be his treasured possession, chosen and cherished? How does this covenant made at Mount Sinai help me articulate my own love story of redemption and to embrace my true identity? There is a fable of a farmer who was walking through the forest one day, and he found a young eaglet who had fallen out of his nest. And he took the young eagle home and he put it in his chicken coop, where the eagle grew strong and healthy and matured. But it had learnt to eat and behave like the chooks that it lived with. One day a naturalist passed by the farm and he noticed the eagle, and he asked why the king of all the birds was confined to live in a barnyard with the chickens. And the farmer replied that he'd only ever given it chicken feed, treated it like all the other chickens, so it had never learnt to fly. Since it ate like a chicken, behaved like a chicken, it was a chicken, said the farmer. It is no longer an eagle. But it still has the heart of an eagle, replied the naturalist. It can surely be taught to fly. He took the eagle outside the coop and he lifted it up towards the sky and he said, "You belong to the sky and not to the earth. Stretch out your wings and fly." The eagle, however, was confused. He saw the chickens eating their food and he jumped down to scratch with them again. The naturalist took the bird to the roof of the house and he urged him again, saying, "You are an eagle, stretch forth your wings and fly." But the eagle was afraid of this unknown view of the world and he jumped down once more for the safety of the chicken coop and his familiar chicken food. Finally, the naturalist took the eagle out of the farmyard to a high mountain. There he held the king of the birds high above him and encouraged him, saying, "You are an eagle. You belong to the sky. Stretch forth your wings and fly." The eagle looked around, back towards the barnyard, and then up towards the sky. And the naturalist lifted him higher, straight towards the sun. And it happened that the eagle began to tremble, slowly stretched his wings, and with a triumphant cry, soared away on the currents into the heavens. It may be that the eagle still remembers the chickens with nostalgia. It may even be that he occasionally revisits the barnyard. But as far as anyone knows, the eagle has never returned to lead a life of a chicken. God saw within the Israelites that they had taken on the identity of a chicken when he had actually created them to be eagles. He lovingly brings them into covenant so that they can soar like an eagle, that they can live out their best lives, bear their best families in their best community. God sees us just like that naturalist, that our lives can easily be institutionalized into a chicken coop. He wants to teach us to live and fly according to our true identity, the one that he has created for us. Dimple sent me a photo of her name badges from three employment positions with the question, "What do you see?" And as I looked at these three name badges, I saw a profound statement of progression. The first badge emphasized her role, but we are not a role. which in this case didn't even closely reflect the extent of Dimple's qualifications or capacity. The second badge emphasised the organisation. We are not our organisation. We are not the machinery of an institution. We are not the logo or the address or the strapline or their history. But the last badge, that just had her name on it. Just Dimple. Dimple, not roles and organisations. Just Dimple, named by her earthly father with affection, called by her heavenly father to bring joy, positioned strategically by her family, her heavenly father. Enough. She is enough. And I think they got that name badge right. God has more for us than a chicken coop. Whether we are underestimated, unseen, or institutionalized, he is teaching us to soar into our true identity. But that only comes with boundaries and the privileges of relationship. That is our part of covenant, learning to know and to love and to devote ourselves to God more and more. Just like every covenant in the Old Testament, this covenant is pointing us forward to Jesus, the greatest revelation of God, who is coming, the one who abides forever. As followers of Jesus, we are his treasured possession. We have the privilege of being given the tools to learn to fly into our true identity. Our part is to stay connected to God with fidelity. Support our love in our faith family with encouragement, to feed our desire to know God even better. This covenant was transforming the people of Israel who had been slaves, chickens in a chicken coop, into a nation with an identity who would carry salvation and blessing to all people. As followers of Jesus, let us be careful that we don't go back to the chicken coop, but to protect the freedom Jesus so valiantly fought for us. And then we can walk, even fly, in the identity that God created us to have. And then we can walk, even fly, in the call which God has given us to fulfill. Let's pray. Father God, it is such a privilege to know that you have created us with intention. That, Father, you see our heart, the heart that you created for us, even when to other people we look like chickens, or even when we identify ourselves as chickens. Father God, we thank you that your love covenant gives us the opportunity to break free from that slavery, that we can be all the things that you have created us to be, that we can walk in the call that you have called and given to us. Father God, we thank you so much that your covenant is a covenant of love, that you call us your treasured possession, that you tell us to walk in your ways, because that brings us closer to you, closer to who you have pictured for us to be. We thank you, Father God, for this beautiful story of the covenant between Moses and the people of Israel and yourself. And we thank you, Father God, that that is pointing us forward to Jesus, our Messiah. We thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.